Hello and welcome to the Reviews Brothers, where we have been taking a big old look at hidden gems for the PlayStation 1, because it's a great console with some great games, many of which people, including me, never got to try. This time round we're on the letter E, and I'll be showing you 10 games, starting with that erotic, exciting, edible letter that you might want to check out, and maybe some that you won't. It was a tricky letter to find games for. Anyway, make sure you check out other videos in the series so you don't miss out on some great games, and of course click that subscribe button so you can watch all the awesome videos I have coming up. Now, how about I shut the hell up and we take a look at some games. Let's start with a game that I wasn't going to include on the list, as I think everyone knows about it by now, but that doesn't mean it's not good, and that game is Einhander from Square. Einhander is a side-scrolling shooter where you pilot a robo-spaceship and have to fight other robo-spaceships in the future. The game looks great and everything is made up with polygons, which look decent enough. Everything runs at a super smooth frame rate here, which is ideal, and the fast-paced action rarely gives you time to breathe. Also, thanks to the 3D graphics, the game does some really cool things with the camera, moving it around at times to give a more cinematic view of larger enemies or explosions. This is never overused and it always looks cool. When you start the game, you can choose from three ships. They're all kind of similar, so it doesn't really matter which one you choose. They each have a basic machine gun, which does a good job against smaller enemies, but before long you'll come up against some bigger bastards that take a ton of hits. Thankfully, you can collect weapons from a number of your enemies. In fact, there's loads of extra weapons you can get here, with more being introduced as you progress. These range from Gatling guns to lasers and, of course, homing missiles. All of these weapons do use ammo, though, so you can't go too crazy with them. What's cool, though, is that you can have two of these weapons equipped at any one time, and you can even keep some in reserve so you can switch between them on the fly, as some weapons are better in different situations than others, and some are better against different enemies. The weapons here are equipped depending on which angle you collect them from. You can either get them from above so they equip on top, or below so they equip below you. So getting the right setup for you can take some time to figure out, but it's great to try all the combinations. You also have a button that adjusts between a few different speed settings. This comes in very handy for dodging enemies and attacks, and you'll be doing this a lot. The game is not easy, and it's just one hit for you and you are dead. You do get a few continues, but it will definitely take some practice to get through this one. It really is a great game though, and one that any fan of action games or space shooters should try out. Fighting game time now with Evil Zone from Yuke's. This is a one-on-one 3D fighting game with a crazy story about beings and people that exist in two dimensions at once. One of these dimensions being the Evil Zone, you'll be shocked to hear. So you do the usual thing of kicking the stuffing out of people so they get back in line. The gameplay here is actually pretty unique and it can take a while to get used to. Despite there being 327 buttons on a PlayStation 1 controller, this game actually only uses two of them, one attack and one to guard. Well, actually use the shoulder buttons to strafe, so that's not entirely true. You'd think that having just one attack button would mean the combat is very shallow, but actually Evil Zone manages to let you pull off a ton of special moves and combos using just that one button. This works by holding different directions, double tapping, holding down the button, and even what distance you are from your opponent, which all alter the attacks that you'll do. And actually, it becomes quite natural, and even with the new characters, I found that I had a pretty good idea of what direction an attack to do and when. What also sets it apart is that most of the game uses ranged attacks, and getting up close and personal is often a last resort. All the attacks have their own animations, and you often get cutscenes for some of the more powerful ones, which always actually look really good thanks to the great graphics and excellent animation. The character selection is your typical Japanese anime roster of big brutish men with massive swords, cocky teacher-looking blokes that keep their hands in their pockets, big boobed sassy women, and of course, schoolgirls that always like to show off their underwear. So there really is something for everyone, I suppose. Each character has their own stage too, and though they aren't interactive or anything, it doesn't really matter, as it's always nice to be fighting somewhere different for each match. This is actually a pretty tough game too, and the enemy AI always puts up a good fight, effectively blocking and countering your attacks, but countering, which is done by timing your block just right, is actually quite easy to get used to, so the matches do tend to be reasonably fair. The game was actually a real surprise when I played it. It took a few matches to understand how to play, but when you do, it's actually really good fun, and it's perfect for someone new to 3D fighting games, as they'll be able to pull off a ton of cool moves without needing complicated button combinations. Definitely one to check out. Here is Eternal Eyes from Sunsoft, and it has the honour of being the first strategy RPG that I've ever played, and you know what? Turns out I quite like them. So yeah, this is a strategy RPG with your usual story of a bunch of kids who have to save the world from monsters. This time, you're known as an Eternal Eye, and while I don't entirely know what that means really, what I do know is that you have the ability to possess creepy puppets with rings that you find, and these turn them into one of more than 100 monster types that you can then use to take with you on your adventure and battle other monsters. Kinda like Pokemon, but not really. The way this works here is that you collect gems, normally from enemies you've defeated, but some can also be bought in shops. Then you use some of these gems on a blank puppet that you acquire as the story progresses, and depending on the stone you use, you get a different monster. Each monster has their unique attacks, stats, and magic. You have no say as to what monster you're going to actually get, but you do get certain ones depending on the gems that you use, so you can kind of dictate what kind of type you'll get. What's cool here is that it's actually the puppet that levels up and not the monster. This means that if your monster buddy is killed in battle, it just turns back to its puppet form. Then, as long as you don't die yourself and have a few of those gems, you can throw one at the puppet corpse and it immediately turns into a new monster. Or if the current ones you have aren't good against certain enemy types, you can just use a gem and switch it to a new one. This is a really cool premise that got me hooked pretty much straight away. In between battles, you'll be exploring the usual towns, etc., where you can buy new weapons and armor for your main character to make him more powerful. You can also get accessories for your puppet monsters that give them stat boosts and can be equipped before entering any dungeons. The meat of the game are the battles, of course, and these are all turn-based and done on a grid. Depending on your stats and equipment, each of your characters has different movement and ranged attacks. Typically, the slower characters have higher attack power and so on. You can make two actions per character per turn, which usually means move or attack, and you can't do two of the same action in one turn, so choose carefully. You also need to take note of the terrain, as if you're too high or low compared to your opponent, you won't be able to hit them, but if you are still in range, then being above your enemy does do extra damage. The battles here are actually a good speed, and though sometimes they would drag on a bit, they always kept me interested, and you level up at a good pace, so you don't have to do a ton of grinding, which is nice. The graphics here are really good 2D sprites with 3D environments, and it all works well. I love the variety in the monsters, and just wish that there was more animation for attacks and magic, as you see a lot of them being reused. The story is good, but the usual overly complex RPG fare with a ton of side characters spouting nonsense a lot of the time is a bit annoying, though luckily you can speed through just most of it. What I like about this one is that everything does move at a good pace, so you don't spend hours at the start of the game with just a sword in your hand in a forest fighting slime. You actually get moving quite quickly, and the game is fun to pick up and play. Well worth a look if you like this sort of stuff. Let's look at a couple of cracking games now, shall we? And first up is Egg, a game that never left Japan, of course. This is a strange strategy game where you, for some reason, are an egg, and like all good eggs do, you have to roll around a tile-based world. As you roll, you leave a trail of shrubbery behind you. If you manage to make a good enough enclosed space, it fills in and houses and other buildings are made. All the while, you have an opponent egg that's doing the same thing, and every level tasks you with creating more land than your opponent. At least that's what it seems like. Everything is in Japanese, though I didn't have any trouble playing the game and kind of figuring out what I had to do. You can roll over your opponent's land to destroy their stuff, and of course they can do the same to you. Also, as you roll, you build up a meter that lets you set off a number of different things to mess with your opponent. You can create tidal waves and explosions that devastate a load of squares, so you want to use these when you're close to the enemy. But this isn't as easy as you'd think. As you're an egg, you never roll in a straight line. Instead, you go all over the place. And though you can sort of guess how the roll is going to go based on your trajectory and angles, it doesn't always work out the way you'd think, and you can end up going all over the place. However, when you get it right and create a huge landmass, there is a massive amount of satisfaction. or when you make it into the enemy base and destroy their tower, it just feels good. You can also collide with the other egg, and you do have to be careful though, because eggs are fragile, and you can crack and fall apart if you're too reckless. Gameplay wise, that's really all there is to it. You choose the angle of your roll and do some rolling, but it gets really addictive, and although I do think it could do with being a bit faster, I felt like I had to just keep playing. The graphics here are decent enough, it's all 2D sprites and reminds me a lot of old strategy and sim games for the PC, which I guess it kind of plays like. Sound and music wise, the game is nothing really all that special, and it has a surreal sort of soundtrack which does suit the game, and really that's all there is to say about it. It is fairly simple, and the gameplay is pretty damn addictive. You can even play this with two players, which I haven't tried, but I can imagine it being great fun to piss off your mate by smashing up their base with a massive explosion. Check this one out any way you can. If you prefer your eggs with legs, then you might want to check out Eggs of Steel. Here you play as Charlie, the poorly animated egg, and you've got to stop your factory from being overrun by an evil egg and his robot minions. You can do this by exploring each level of the factory, collecting items and punching time cards. Once you've found all the time cards on a stage, it's on to the next. The levels are actually pretty large and can be quite maze-like. You'll need to explore every nook and cranny, solving simple puzzles in order to get the punch cards to appear. These range from pressing switches to killing enemies and just about everything in between. It's definitely not easy though, as there are loads of places in the level that you can fall off, and the controls here aren't particularly great, especially the jerky jumping sections where you'll likely fall to your death quite a lot. This is one of those games where I found myself spending most of my time saying, "What the fuck is going on?" It's filled with so many random events and crazy videos happening all the time that it's often hard to know what the hell is going on. Charlie can run and jump, which you'll need to do to get around the levels, but you can also throw these nuts that you find to activate switches, and you also have a really awesome roll move that cracks me up with the sound that you make. This roll is much faster than walking, but can be hard to control. You can also attack with your massive wrench, which does a pretty good job of smashing the robot enemies to bits, though the hit detection is pretty poor, so expect to take some damage quite often. The graphics here are not so good. Everything is pre-rendered and kind of looks okay, but the animation is so jerky and awkward it can affect the controls, and there's really no excuse for the poor animation, because games like Donkey Kong Country on the previous generation of consoles did everything so much better. There are huge bonus levels dotted around, which you'll need coins that you collect in the levels to play. These give you extra lives, and you'll need them as the game is pretty damn tough, but mainly thanks to poor design and dodgy control rather than a genuine challenge. There are bosses here, and these are actually quite fun to fight and to figure out their patterns. Something that is really noticeable is that there's a ton of cutscenes here. After just about everything you do, you get one. They're all short, lasting about a minute or so, and they're meant to be funny, but fail just about every time. You know what, they really remind me of those scenes that you get from bowling screens in bowling alleys, where totally random shit just seems to happen that's barely connected to the on-screen action. So, is this really a hidden gem? Well, kind of no, it's actually pretty terrible. But I wanted to include it anyway, as it actually is one of those games that's so bad, it's kind of good. It's one of those ones that I try to get people to play just so they can experience the craziness like I had to. So yeah, make sure you check this one out. It's that time of the video again where we go overseas to see what Japan got that us puny Westerners didn't. And first up is the stupidly named EOS Edge of Sky. This is a 3D rail shooter that plays kind of similarly to games like Afterburner or even Panzer Dragoon, but don't get too excited, it's not that good, though it is still a lot of fun. As it's Japanese, you've got a mech craft that can switch between fighter jet form and a mech form. As far as I could tell, there was no difference between them. They have the same weapons and performance. The only real thing that changed was the shape of your aircraft, and because of this, I stayed as the fighter jet as it made me a smaller target. Then you fly through a bunch of levels taking out pesky bad guys with your infinite supply of machine gun ammo and homing rockets. Much like Panzer Dragoon, you can lock onto enemies by holding the shoot button and moving your crosshair over them. This is a really handy way of taking out groups of bad guys, and you'll be relying on it a lot. Your machine gun is alright, but the game moves really fast, so being accurate with it is pretty tricky. Also, enemies shoot at you a lot, so you'll want to be constantly moving so you can avoid their bullets. Thankfully, you can take a few hits before you're destroyed, though as far as I can tell, there's no way to refill your health in the levels, and you only get one life, and then you have to use a continue. Thankfully, you don't have to replay the whole stage, and there are checkpoints in the levels. The controls here are pretty smooth, and it's all easy to pick up and play. You don't need to know Japanese to enjoy this one. There is, of course, a story and lots of talking here, so if you do want to figure out what's going on, you might need a bit of a guide. But I settled with just knowing that I'm good, and I need to blow up the bad guys. The graphics here are alright, there's nothing mind-blowing. The levels are varied, and they really do remind me of the ones in the Panda Dragoon games. In fact, even a lot of the insect-like enemies remind me of them too, but that's not a bad thing. The draw distance is also pretty good here, with not too much popping. The bosses are all fun to fight, and actually pretty damn hard to take down. Each one took me a while to learn their patterns and know when to attack and when to hide in the corner. This is a pretty simple shooter that isn't going to change your life, however it is well made and plays pretty well. It's just the right amount of challenge and will definitely entertain you while you play through it. How about a crazy puzzle game now, called Inchargo? This is a wacky, addictive puzzle game where you play as a little kid, and it looks like he has all sorts of phobias and OCDs, all of which have come to life and turned into crazy monsters. There's butt monsters, booger monsters, smelly monsters, and kissy monsters. It's all bonkers and played for laughs. But what do you actually do in the game, I hear you cry? Well, calm down, dear, I'll tell you. You play as the boy, and you're put into a level made of tiles, along with some of the monsters. Then you have a certain number of moves in order to make it to the blue exit square on the board. Simple. Only after every time you make a move, the monsters then make their move. The thing is that each monster has a different movement pattern that you'll need to accommodate for. So, what I mean is, some of the monsters move the opposite to you. So, if you move up, they move down. You go left, they go right. Others will be 90 degree different, meaning that if you move up, they'll go left, you go down, they'll go right. And of course, there's a number of combinations of these. The game starts off easy enough with only one or two of the same monster, so it's quite easy to figure out how to get them into dead ends so they can't leave or get you. But pretty soon, you'll have a combination of monsters that are all moving in different directions for you to avoid, and boy, it gets tough, especially if you're stupid like me. Also, depending on where you're standing, some tiles are darkened out. If a monster is on a dark tile, they will fall asleep, so they won't move until the spot lights up again. This seems to be done in a line of sight basis, so if you can't see the square, it will turn dark, though I couldn't quite figure it out. You will need to use this though, as some maps are impossible if the monsters aren't asleep for at least a couple of turns. I'll be honest, I really sucked at this game, but I couldn't stop myself from playing. It's really addictive. Each time I tried, I would get a little bit further. It's all 2D sprites here, and looks like it could come from a cartoon. It actually made me think of the Real Monsters game that's available for the SNES or Mega Drive, or Genesis if you're a thick boy. Now go listen to the Secret Levels podcast review of that game to find out more. What I quite like here is that when you're trapped by a monster, you get a cutscene of them doing something gross to you. Now, as a testament to how bad I am at this game, I thought the two of these animations that I got to see were really cool, so I actually tried to get myself killed to see them all, but I'm so bad that I couldn't even figure out how to get myself killed. This is partly because the game won't actually let you walk onto a space with a monster on it, forcing you to move in different directions. This is kind of good as you can't accidentally die, but it did mean I couldn't see all of the animations. The sound and music here are wacky stuff too, and they really suit the game, though the music can get a bit annoying. And you know what, that's about it. It's a pretty simple puzzle game, but it's really damn fun, and I highly recommend playing it. This is a good one to play with a group of people, as you can all chip in to help figure out how best to beat the level. Definitely check this one out anywhere you can. Back to the West now, for Elemental Gearbolt, a light gun shooter that I was convinced was based on an anime that I've never seen before, but as far as I can tell, it turns out that it's all for the game, which is a shame as it looked pretty damn cool and I wanted to watch it. There's a lot of story here about mechs and angels, and it's a cool blend of fantasy and science fiction, and the game has you play as a punk kid who wants to rescue the fairy folk from robot bastards.
It's a rail shooter, so all you have to worry about is pointing your cursor on the enemies and pressing the shoot button. You've got three weapons, and they all have unlimited ammo, and you can switch between them whenever you like. You have a normal shot that's pretty powerful and fires at a medium rate. Then you've got a rapid burst fire that shoots a lot of bullets in one go that aren't that powerful, but are good if you hit your enemy all in one go. And then there's the pink spread shot that's kind of like a shotgun. It's not much good at a distance, but it fires a spray of bullets that's devastating up close. It won't take you long to figure out your favorite weapon, as well as which one works best in each situation. The graphics here are a really good mix of polygons and sprites, and I really love the art style here. The enemies all look great, and the stages are varied and fun. The animation is fantastic, and it all runs at a very smooth pace. Now, what's cool here is that you've got three options for controls. You can, of course, use a light gun if you're lucky enough to have a setup that allows it, or you can use the controller, which works fine, but is probably the hardest way to play. Or you can even use the PlayStation Mouse, which I wish I knew about before I played, as I actually have one of those. This would have been a great way to play the game and would have made it so much easier. This is not an easy game, you see. There's a ton of enemies after your blood. You do get an indicator letting you know which ones are about to attack, which is great, but getting to them in time to kill them is hard with the controller. Also, they fire a lot of projectiles at you, which you can shoot down, but again, this would be so much easier with a mouse. So, I highly recommend using one if you're going to play this and don't have the use of a light gun. Also, on your levels, you'll find fairies. You can rescue these by shooting them to break the barrier that holds them. These are mainly for points, but sometimes they'll drop extra health or power-ups, so it's always worth saving them if you come across them. I've always had a soft spot for light gun games, and this one did not disappoint. It's a lot of fun, with some amazing animated cutscenes and some really fun, challenging gameplay. I'm guessing the stupid name didn't do any favours over here, as I'd never heard of it. Thankfully, Working Designs did a proper translation, and it's a hell of an enjoyable game. Definitely one that I recommend if you like this sort of thing. Next up is Excalibur 2555 AD by Telstar Electronic Studios Limited Games. You know, Telstar Electronic Studios Limited. They made all your favourites. This is a third-person action-adventure where you are on a mission to retrieve the legendary sword Excalibur, which has been stolen by evil time travellers who went back in time to steal it and kill King Arthur. You're then fast-forwarded to 2555 AD, where the world has gone to shit because evil bastards have that sword. On the plus side, there are robots. And thankfully, in the future, it's a compulsory thing for all female heroes to always show their underwear. So the future is looking bright, everyone. Now, I'll tell you right away that this game is not going to win any awards for any aspects of its existence. It's pretty ugly, it has clunky controls, terrible voice acting, but you know what? I actually really like it. The gameplay is similar to many 3D action games of the era. You use tank controls and explore a number of locations looking for items to help you progress, by either using them in the environment or giving them to people you meet along the way, who will then help you out. All the characters are fully voiced, I'm assuming by the developers though, as it's kind of bad, but it does have a charm to it. I did say earlier that the controls were clunky, and it's true, but they're not terrible, and the game is still perfectly playable. It's one of those ones where you hold the attack button and then each different direction on the D-pad does a different attack. And also, the longer you hold the direction, the more powerful your attack gets. You also have a pretty handy block which is easy to use, and you'll need to use it often, as nearly all enemies will kick your ass if you're not careful. Interacting with objects in your inventory takes a little bit of getting used to. Basically, you can equip an item in the menu and then pressing circle shows that item to whoever or whatever you're standing near. If it's something that can be used with, it'll just magically work. This does look a bit odd when you're doing things like opening doors, as basically all you do is show the key to the door and then the doors will just open for you. The graphics here are not impressive, but the characters are big and chunky and you can tell what everything's meant to be. The game is actually quite tough, as it has an emphasis on puzzles and exploring, and when you do fight enemies, it tends to just be one or maybe two at a time, but that actually works in a game like this. Something that surprised me here is that I never had any issues with the camera. It does a good job of following you around. There are two angles, one of which stays behind you, and the other is sort of an attempt at cinematic angles. This is actually the worst thing, and to be fair, was often in the wrong place, but I never had an issue with the regular behind view. This is clearly a budget game, which you can really tell from the stock sound effects that are used throughout, but if you're willing to put up with a bit of jank, this is actually a pretty fun action title that will likely entertain you for a few hours and provide some unintentional laughs along the way. And finally for today, here is Echo Knight, a survival horror puzzle game from the Kings of Sadism, From Software. This is a first-person horror puzzler that has a cool story where you explore locations and find items that relate to memories of the ghosts of your dead family, or sometimes just other dead people. Then you sort of teleport into those memories and have to play through them to find items to help the spirits that make their way out of the afterlife. Of course, while you're doing this, you unravel the plot of an evil man possessed by an evil stone, and you're hunted by the ghost of a young girl who would like nothing more than to kill you dead. The action is all deliberately slow-paced, and you'll be walking around some nice spooky-looking environments, talking to some spooky people. You've got a crosshair on screen that changes colour when you can interact with whatever it's pointing at, and you'll need to pick up objects and move them around in order to solve puzzles. Also, you need to keep your eyes peeled, as there are plenty of tiny items that you need to give people to progress. You can also search places for health pickups and tools that help you progress and solve puzzles. It's all fairly simple, but really addictive, and the atmosphere in the game is great. It's never actually scary, but it has a very Silent Hill sort of vibe where everything is just not quite right. As I mentioned earlier, you are constantly being chased by a ghost girl who will throw you around the ship you're on, and eventually she'll kill you. If she appears, you need to just get the hell away from her, or if you're in a room that has a light, you need to turn the light on, which will cause her to bugger off, as we know, ghosts don't like the light. This makes for some pretty tense scenes when you're trying to solve a puzzle that will bring the electric back on, or you can see the light switch between you and the ghost girl. It's great. You also have a friendly spirit trader man, who basically has a shop that you can go to and trade souls and other items with him. This is entirely optional, but it was fun to hunt for the soul items that he's after. I also really like the voice acting here. It's not particularly good, but again, the tone of everything is really well done, and it suits the spooky atmosphere of the game. You can save your progress at any phone that you find. These aren't all that common, but they do appear at times that make sense. So when I did die, I never did have to travel too much further back. And thankfully, unlike games like Resident Evil, you can save as often as you like, which is always appreciated. This is not a massively long game, and I actually did manage to finish it in about 5 hours or so without really any help. But that's just fine with me. Sometimes it did come down to just using every item with every other item, but I don't really mind this. Overall, I really enjoyed playing this game. I thought the graphics were great, the gameplay is engaging, and although everything is a little slow, it really kept me wanting to play. So I did. I definitely recommend this one, even if you hold off until spooky season to do so. Thank you for telling me. I will go to her. So there you go, 10 games starting with the letter E that you may not have heard of. As always, let us know in the comments below any other games that we should check out for this or any other letter. On screen now, you can see where you can follow us, so please do so. We've got loads of great content for you to enjoy. Now, all that's left for me to say is thank you for joining us, and we'll see you next time.